Good morning, friends. I'm Saket Bansal, and I run a training organization where we help professionals to grow in their career by learning new things, by improving whatever they are doing. So that is our primary goal, and many of you are our existing customer. So today I'm talking about a cocktail, which I find quite evidently visible in our Indian IT context. Many times we think it's an Indian phenomena, but it could be a global phenomena as well, where we mix two, three drinks, and it makes such a kick kind of a drink, after having that particular thing, you find that what I'm doing. So many things similar is happening in our Agile world. So the session will look like, we will talk about an entry pattern in Agile, where we mix Agile way of execution with traditional way of management. We try to manage our team the way we have been doing. We try to project our timeline the way we have been doing. And we expect team to become self-organized and start working the way Agile expects them to work on. So that is something we will explore how it is happening. And then we will see what kind of a side effect such kind of combination can generate. And then, rather than just standing here abusing people, abusing organization, and making you feel happy, we also need to talk about what is the solution. Because many times in conferences, in events, we go and we say, this is bad, that is bad, and you know, you also feel good because I'm speaking something which you feel. But at the end, we get nothing. We just remove, like, we get out of our frustration, we spend good 1 hour. So we'll try to move towards some solution. What can we do? When I say we, the people who really care about making Agile as a mainstream process for organization, software development, and for doing things and transforming the world of work. So that is something we will go, and that's the last session which we will be, last segment we will get into it. During the segment, I will also make you do some activities, small activities, which will help us primarily to move towards the third stage, where we talk about how can we develop an agile leadership which produce the desired outcome. So before I start, any feedback, any question you want to ask about this particular topic? Even I have not started, but I want to collect some ideas that what you want to get. A question-driven presentation. Yeah, any query or comment? Yeah. Okay, about the conference. This is a catchy name. So Discuss Agile, the fact is I can make any story you want, but actually we were looking for a domain name which is catchy enough, and we got a Discuss Agile and we used it. So most of the time I think names are just like that. After that we think, okay, let's make a story and make it look good. But actually it was more to do with a domain name, which is easy and... Okay, anything about the talk, cocktail? Anybody facing this situation where you have an end date in your mind and you are using Agile? Yeah? Maybe people are not raising their hand, but I think most of us are facing the situation where you have an end date in your mind. The customer is asking 15th December 2016 is live. And you are Agile, you know, I will give whatever you ask, and I will ask as many changes I want, but 15th December 2016 is the date, and this is the money you will get. That's it. Yeah, and if it doesn't happen, I will remove your company from my vendor list. Okay, so this is an entry pattern. Many times we think that Agile can fix most of our software development problem. Is it possible that Agile project starts failing? Anybody seen that project was Agile, but still we are into a mess? Many? So earlier maybe the number was less because we were not in Agile. So last year if I would have asked this question, people say, no, Agile is good because there are only few projects in Agile. But since the Agile software development is becoming a mainstream process, it has also started exposing the issues which can be there irrespective of the type of method you use. So Agile process do fail, Agile-based software development projects do fail. And what makes them fail? Now there are a lot of organizations, bodies who conduct survey about it. Heard of version 1 survey, Scrum Alliance survey, somebody called it state of Agile, somebody calls it state of Scrum. So there are a lot of organizations, consulting organizations, tool selling organizations who conduct surveys. And then they conclude there are X number of reasons for Agile failure. And one of the common themes which they tell is management style and the culture is one of the primary culprits. And you may feel this, that culture is something which is blocking us. Now, but it is very difficult to diagnose the culture and talk about what should we fix so that the problem gets fixed, because culture is such an abstract term. So I thought of, rather than focusing on an abstract term like culture, let's put up some framework. So I put up, I took a reference from McKinsey's 7S framework, which kind of defined the type of organization, the type of culture, the management style we live in. So if we look at a 7S framework, it kind of tells how a culture would be reflecting. A culture is built based on the style of the people, style of the leaders. Culture is built on the basis of the type of people you have, staff. Culture is built on the basis of a structure you build, the organization hierarchy. Do you have a multi-layer hierarchy or less hierarchy is processed? What kind of values? Ultimately, that the shared value starts emerging out of it. So when we do Agile, what do we change? We primarily focus on systems. Okay, we will follow Scrum. We will not have a kickoff meeting. We will have a daily stand-up meeting. We will not have a milestone review. We will have a sprint review. Then we attack a little bit of a structure. Now we have a product owner, Scrum Master, and development team. We don't want to have a team which is called a testing team. So we kind of attack the structure. So these are the things we try to attack. We train people. We train our staff on Agile and Scrum, some part of it. We also try to develop some skills so that they start understanding what? User stories, you know. So I was conducting a meetup session last week only in Bangalore. One participant said that I am facing problem. What is your problem? He says, my senior management wants everybody using Agile. Yeah. But my middle management don't want to use Agile. Like, okay, what they don't want to use? They don't want to talk in Agile terminologies. They don't want to use user stories. They don't want to use product backlog. They don't want to use daily standup. So many of us get educated on these words. Okay, we are educated, but what else? This education may put strain in other areas. The structure, the remaining structure which is not Agile is red now. You're trying to pull something because it's not in harmony. And similarly, the style of people also are strained. I'm confused. If I'm a senior manager, I'm confused how to deal with these creatures who call themselves Scrum team. So the whole process which was there, the whole equilibrium which was there in the organization start getting disturbed. So that happens when we start with it. And many times, the going Agile comes as a news. So management, like many times the CEO attends something, he says, like, let's go Agile. Or you get an RFP which talks about that we need to execute this project in Agile. He says, okay, let's go in Agile. And we just decide that let's get into Agile because it's a buzzword. If the leaders are following, why not to follow it? Anybody saw this kind of syndrome in their organization where nobody understood what it is, but we said we want to go Agile because it's everything. Everything is following Agile, so why not? It must be a good thing. Great, so manager also feels excited many times. Agile means fast delivery. High performance team, who don't like high performance team? Everybody wants to have a high performance team. So they feel good. Less surprises, more transparencies. We know what is going on inside early. That's a great thing. Happy customers. If I will follow Agile, my customer would be happy. So as a management, as a department head, I will feel great about it. So I get all those great expectations, low growth, low cost, high value, more transparency, less surprises, and this is good. So manager thinks, okay, let's figure it out. This looks great. And that is what the manager looks towards the Agile. But team looks at it, okay, it's a more fun, you know, cool thing. We will go home on time. Agile believes on sustainable pace. We can learn new thing. We can improve our profile. People are asking for Agile jobs. So people look Agile from a different perspective. So team starts feeling great, and management starts feeling again great because everybody is going Agile. So this is kind of a team management interaction starts in. Your first project starts. You have kicked off the project using Agile. Management comes to you, manager comes to you. Now, whenever I use a management or manager word, you can map it to a project manager if you wish. You can map it to a program manager. You can map it to a delivery head, or you can even map it to a Scrum Master also in some cases. But I'm using a generic word. A manager comes and says, okay, guys, give me a plan. We need to communicate a release date to customer. We are starting a project. We need to communicate a release date to the customer. And development team, maybe a scrum master you can think of here, says that we don't have such plan. Anybody face this situation where the project manager asks the team, guys, tell me the date. We have this requirement. You have a 2 pages of requirement. We need to follow Agile. Now, what is an estimate for it? And when are we releasing? Have you faced this situation before? Many of you? So you say that we don't have it. Then the manager is also not stupid. He says, no, I have heard about Agile. I have read about Agile. There is something called release planning. Why you guys can't do release planning? Agile never says that don't do release planning. So you end up agreeing, okay, we do have a release plan. Let's make it. And he uses the release plan and communicates the date to the client. Because there's nothing wrong in it. He had a release plan which is coming from an Agile team, and I can project a release date based on that particular plan. So he does that. Then things moves on, and he presents it in a very nice way. Have you seen this kind of presentation? Because he loves Gantt charts. He loves milestones because that is what he has been doing, and that is what his stakeholder understands it. If he presents something else, stakeholder will kick him out. So he uses the language which stakeholder can understand. He makes a plan that, okay, these are the miles, these are the dates we are running iteration 1, iteration 2, iteration 3. Then we will have some special type of iterations, which will do UAT, training, something. And finally, you will be going live on December 16th. So we end up having this kind of a plan. And he tells, here is our plan based on the current scope of work. And as a project manager, I always need to be careful what I speak. So I always say, this is a date based on current scope of work. But nobody hears that. That's a separate issue. Stakeholder will say, Agile will deliver all what we want by 15th December 2016. So I am trying to be politically right, that I will deliver as per the current scope of work, but other people are also knowing now we are Agile. We will get something at the end of 15th of 8. Again, thing starts. So now manager comes to the development team and says, okay, now guys, give me a plan. I have committed some date. Now finally give me a detailed plan. Tell me how the activities are going, who is doing what, so that we can have a final delivery. The team will say, no, we don't have such plan. Yeah? And what the manager will say, what do you have? Team usually give a sprint plan to the guy. It says, okay, we have a sprint plan. Can you live with it? He says, okay, this is Agile. Let's live with the sprint plan. He picks up the sprint plan and start asking questions like, why don't have all the people allocated? What this guy is doing? You know, it's a 2-week sprint. This guy looks under-allocated. Face this situation when the manager starts looking at the sprint plan, but you can't stop him. And why don't you plan only 60% of your capacity? You have 100 hours. Your sprint plan only shows 60 hours. What's wrong with you guys? Why do you have a different type of task for similar type of stories? Like one story is having design testing. Another story is having something else. Why you create inconsistencies in your plan? So you get all these sort of questions, why this guy is not allocated, why this guy is over-allocated, why there is no resource leveling. Maybe if you are a good team, you avoid this guy and say, okay, you don't worry, we are Agile, we know we are self-organized, we will take care of it. And you somehow kick this guy away, and this guy feels uncomfortable, but think that in Agile, self-organizing team, let's give them a chance. Then what happens? Sprint review. After all these questions, people come together, and whatever you plan, only 50% complete. So earlier, when you were looking at a sprint plan, manager or project manager was already pissed off with you because you have not planned it well. And when the sprint gets over, you give him a surprise. You know, 50% work is done. Remaining 50% is not done. Now what does he do? He says, you guys are really crazy, you know. Next time, I will do all the planning. You don't understand how to do planning, and it was a mistake that I trusted you guys too much. Happened with some of you, where you end up get bashed up in a first sprint review meeting, and unfortunately even customers was not there. A manager feels good about it. At least this is a home issue. I don't have to expose this issue to the end customer. So he gets angry, and he really gets angry and thinks, what do I do now? How can I tell this to the client? How can I tell this to my manager that we are 50%? And how do I make sure that team starts reducing this variance? He starts thinking and he gets pissed off with all these issues. Now, what he does? Anybody project manager who has faced this situation before here? As a project manager, so what do? We make some story. Yeah? We say, so that is what we tell to manager. We had some technical issue in the first sprint. You know, we have to be nice. If we could not complete some of the stories, though the work is 90% complete. Yeah, it's not done, but I know it's 90% complete. So actually we are 90%, we are not 50%. And don't worry, we will fix it in the next sprint onwards. That is what you do as a project manager. And to the team, you say, guys, you don't know how to plan and execute. Next time I will do sprint planning, you guys go away. Happens? Now, where are we going with the Agile and Scrum then? This is like a day-to-day story, but where we are heading towards? We are heading towards an unbalanced stage. An unbalanced stage where a management is taking control of planning and monitoring, and we are expecting team to become adaptive, self-organized, and transparent. The more and more you try to become planned and monitored, these things will go down. The problem is, when we were doing traditional management as a project manager, we never get that much visibility of project. We had a milestones. And those milestones used to come after month, 2 months, 3 months, like that. And team used to put all the buffers and contingency to make sure at least milestones looks green, at least. And manager was used to of doing only variance analysis. And that variance analysis he used to do at a frequency after 2 months, 3 months. So now with Agile and Scrum, here, if he starts doing that variance analysis at every sprint end, we are into a mess. Because the Agile transparency and monitoring was never meant for variance analysis. But the project management leaders who only know running and controlling the project and delivering the customer satisfaction based on following a predictable plan and controlling if something goes here and there. And usually, as I interact with Agile professionals in India, I find these issues most of the cases. Anybody following me? Are you seeing this kind of strain in your organization? Most of us? No, what do we do? Now, who are we? People who believe Agile-based software development is need of hour. Else we don't do anything, we follow the same structure. We remain Agile, we start putting some buffers next sprint onwards. We start overestimating our things, like adding estimate to our development activity, and we go to the previous style where we had a sufficient buffer so that variance can be controlled, and somehow we reduce the transparency, we reduce the definition of done, and try to fit into the structure. That is what most of us end up doing, but if we really care about it, what can we do? So this is something I want you to think about for 3 minutes. On a table, what can we do about this situation? I am working with an assumption that most of us have seen this, this situation or have faced this situation at some pockets. Now what can we do about it? 3 minutes, think about and come up with some of the conclusion from your table. So you need to think and have a conversation around. While you are thinking, you can write something on your notepad. Once you have that, maybe you can discuss with your peer, not necessarily the whole table. 2-3 people can discuss and come up with some conclusion in 3 minutes time. Start discussing in a group once you are done with your initial level of thinking. You just have 3 minutes time. Yeah. You guys should not sit together. Yeah, you should get merged. You will get more customer if you spread across rather than sitting together. Yeah. Like this. Team. No, you are as a person who want to evangelize Agile. So how do you take care of? You can coach team, you can coach project manager. You think, I don't want you to use the word, you can think like an Agile coach. Yeah. So anybody who cares that people should follow Agile, if you care, how do you move forward? So what do you do? If the person is doing like this, what do you do? Coach is one of the solutions. You keep training them people. Okay, so we are done with 3 minutes. So time box is over. It's a good time to consolidate now. So I hope you got some insights. And many of insights might be, is there something different than this? Or you got some other insights? How many of you want to blame the manager? This guy should be replaced, this guy should be coached, he's a useless guy. How many want to blame the manager for this mess? Okay, throw him out, great. Most of you are, so people are blaming you, so you can say that they blame me. Okay, and sometimes blame the client. Why client don't attend the things? Why they need a predictable date? They are following Agile, they should know Agile. How many of you want to blame the client? Managers usually blame the client. You know, I am forced to do this, that's why I'm forcing my team to do this. Possible? But I said that you are an Agile evangelist. You are the people who want to make Agile work. You are not a project manager, you are not a team member. You are thinking maybe a term called Agile coach, somebody who wants to fix this. Many times you think of training the manager. How many of you concluded that we should train the guy? Yeah, many of you, great. Give him a certified Scrum Master class, but you will say that he's already CSM, CSP, whatever P you want to put, he's already there. You know, many of you might be already having a trained manager but behaving in a similar way. You know, it doesn't work in a real world. And I have heard of Agile, I have attended 100 conferences. These people talk about book. When we have to deliver, this client is sending mail to me. Do you want to see the mail? Or do you want to read the Scrum guide? Yeah? Had a situation? I used to have a manager who used to tell me the type of mail and pressure I get, you might have committed suicide by now. So he used to tell me like this, yeah, and you are telling you guys are pressurized. Well, I will show what I am going through. Okay, I am not saying that. Go back to waterfall. Maybe in between, keep working as it goes, call it hybrid Agile. Yeah, most of settle down here, yeah. And in fact, I have a session on hybrid Agile. But many of say that, okay, let's team keep doing what they are doing. Let's put them some buffer. Let's have a visibility on milestone and put something. So both thing works out. So we remain iterative. We are anyway iterating. We are showing something at increment. But who forces us to become a management style which is compatible with Agile? Let's remain iterative and traditional together. And I think many of us settle down here. Yeah. But is it right? And many times what I feel is a project manager or a coach or a team end up settling down here because we don't understand the manager. We don't have an empathy with the manager. We believe he's a crazy guy and he's the source of all the problem. We never understand this guy has a need. And the need is I need to have a visibility and predictability when we are going to deliver. And I need to have a consistent view, are we reaching there or we are not reaching there? And if we are not reaching there, what can be done? He has that need. Now, that's a separate issue that he is presenting that need in a different way. He is presenting that need by a way of controlling you. And client also has a need. They have created their business case based on the project which you are working on. If the business case goes down, their stakeholder will ask, you guys are spoiling my company money. So they have a reasons to behave in a way, but the problem is they are expressing that need in a different way to you, and you only see the expression. You means the people who think Agile is good, they only see the expression. We don't get into the need of the person. And if we want to think about a need, we can think of an empathy map for a manager. If you spend just 5 minutes on a table or an individual, just thinking of these dimensions, so visualize the project manager who is troubling you, or visualize the client who is troubling you. Just you received an email from last week. Just pick up something which you have got in the last 1 month only. And I'm sure everybody must have these instances in just 1 month time period. You don't have to go back beyond your time. If you just think of these things, what this particular client sees, what he hears, what he think and feel, what he say and what he do, what are his pains and gains. And spending 5 minutes, in my view, will give you an idea for a solution which can make Agile work without putting bandages. Would you want to explore for 5 minutes? Just 5 minutes? Okay? You can do it in a team, 2-3 people, whoever's sitting together, and create an empathy map for a manager or a client. Time starts now. Okay, so how was the experience? Now, do you have a different solution than the previous one? Last time also you were trying to think about a solution. This time you didn't think about a solution, but you start connecting with the person who you think is a source of a problem. And my expectation is that you get a better connectivity with the guy and may be able to find the solutions, which is good for him as well as for you, faster. Does this exercise give you some insight about the person whom you are dealing with? Because you are empathizing with the guy. See, in many of the empathy is a religious subject. Buddhism focuses on it too much. And one section of a Buddhism also believes that whatever we believe, whatever we see, is just a projection of our mind. Everybody has a different universe. And there is no truth in this universe. Everything is coming from your projection of your mind. So if we take that thing forward, where you look at that there is someone who is creating a source of a problem, there could be a possibility that I am unable to see his word. And because of that, his word and my word is different, and that's why we have a huge conflict. So if we start empathizing, we may get a better solution. And we start making our managers, customers, stakeholders moving away from adding too much value. What is adding too much value? You know, you need to plan it like this. I will tell you how to do a sprint planning. How many of you might be doing this with your teams? As a manager, we have a habit of adding too much value. If something is going on, we want to have value add. You didn't ask me, I know something, I can tell you. So we want to make them, don't add too much value. We are judgmental. You know, this thing won't work. So we want to stop these people rather than thinking that these guys don't know about planning. You can talk, you can participate in retrospective. That's okay, that's good. But rather than passing the judgment, many times if the situation becomes too worse, the manager also starts withholding information. To client, he changes the date to February 2017, but for the team, it still remains mid-December 2016 because he started playing the game. And many of you, and this is a favorite project manager's questions, because I have been a project manager and PMP and all those stuff. You know, why can't we have two dates? One internal date and one external date. Why this PMP, the MPP doesn't have two dates? I don't want to disclose the second date. Now we can say this guy is crap, but again, we can, if we empathize with the guy, he's unable to trust us. So that's why he results into a withholding information. Taking credit, no, I did it, I made this sprint pass, else the project was failing. Pushing things, passing the buck. Now, how many times you have faced a situation where you are into an escalation? You are into an escalation and your manager just find a one guy and create a story like this. This is the one who has created everything. That's it. And he smartly becomes safe. And it happens usually when the seniors are also as stupid as like this manager. If you have a smart senior, he won't let you do it. You say, shut up, tell me this. Don't make somebody an escape goat. But many of us don't face a situation where the seniors are that much smart and manager is smarter than them and he makes an escape goat. So we want to make people away from it and we want to take them towards a stage where they start giving freedom, they start building confidence in the people, they start creating, believing in a self-organizing team, believing in servant leadership and the coaching attitude, an environment where people can do better work. And it is possible. If we start fixing our communication, if we start empathizing with it. See, it's a journey. It's a journey, and there is no one way to win this whole process, but empathy can help. It's very easy to talk about the problems, and you may go into a lot of conferences, a lot of blogs, a lot of places where people just criticize. Management doesn't know Agile, culture doesn't know Agile, client doesn't know Agile. What do you do by doing criticizing? I can make you laugh, I can create a mimicry of a manager. He says he's just a stupid guy and you all feel good about it. But it doesn't solve the issue. The solution can only come if we really care about it. We need to empathize and find a way which can make things work. So that's the only message which I wanted to give at the end of this particular session. If you have any follow-up question, I am here to help. Try at least answering these questions. Yeah. You know, we expect everything from the universe. Yeah, that's a common thinking process that if somebody gives you a knowledge, and I was taking a coaching class last week in Bangalore, so I taught them how to do coaching and all, and first thing I told about them about coaching is, don't start giving gyan of coaching from tomorrow. Because what happens if we learn something new, we expect everybody else should fix and follow the new thing. I will remain as I am. So if I learn how to empathize, I will expect she to empathize with me. I am okay, I am already okay. So if I learn how to have a coaching conversation, not to push people, I will share about it on LinkedIn and Twitter and expect everybody will be following that, except me. Won't happen. It's impossible to change someone in this universe. The easiest person you can change is you. And that is the most difficult part, but that's the easiest looking at the changing circumstances. You may find it's impossible, but that is the only possible thing. Start from yourself. You can't expect empathy or anything from anyone till the time you give, especially. Any other question? Interesting. Thank you for raising that. Yeah. That is expected. So the expectation of, and why it is expected? Again, as an agile professional, we also need to see why. The situation of today's world is so dynamic. If we start trusting a one guy to navigate the complete journey, it's risky. The organization will lose money if I just try to trust intelligence of a one guy. So as an organization, I want to save myself by creating a collective planning and accountability. And that is the reason in agile world, we believe in self-organizing team. So they plan, they own, and they do the thing as a one unit. Rather than something goes wrong, it was his plan. Date, you are the project manager, I'm just a development team member. Yeah, we did everything as he said, but project didn't give us good ranking. It was his fault. We end up doing blames. And that's what we kind of habitual of doing. It's a difficult habit. But that is where the management and organization wants to take us away from. Yeah.
I can, do that. For my manager, I can empathize with him and I understand his problems because he eventually comes up to me as a product owner that you have to force the team or you have to tell the team what is the end date and this is something that you have to follow. Then how would you make sure that you're
team understands
is empathizing
that.
With you and then eventually
see,
the manager.
This is the art of coaching or art of communication. If you are the guy who is expected to lead the group, then you need to master the art of empathizing and communicating. And communicating is using less judgment, using facts, and when somebody tells, the person may say, sir, you are pushing us too much. You are making us work hard. Now what it is? It's just a judgment. There's no fact in it. Then when you hear this, you say, okay, I'm hearing that you are finding it stressful. Can you be more clear about which part of the work allocation is becoming stressful? He says that I want to go home at 6 o'clock. Great, now you have something which you can address. So many times, the whole universe or the whole reality which we create is controlled by the communication, the words we use. And as a leader, you can control that reality by controlling the words. So now we are getting into a little bit non-violent communication and conversation area. But as a coach, as a leader, we control the conversation around. So by focusing on his language, by responding to his need, you can bring a gradual change. But it's going to be a very difficult path because first, in the initial stage, you yourself is not convinced. So it requires a self-discipline before even we can. Yes, final question.
Sir, just a little more than empathy, because empathy, When you're working on Agile, at times I've seen people say that we don't have time to empathize. Actually, people should be doing their job because it's. So I think one of the things to empathy is very important. One of the things to add when individual look at it, just look above and beyond what you do. Actually, so empathizing is very very much important. But I think just looking beyond what the work you're responsible for, just look. And when you have that kind of mindset, you would be able to actually really be able to empathize and understand the situation of the other people.
So what you are saying is that maybe take a baby steps, initially make them clear about the upcoming stages first, and then gradually take it them towards an empathized environment. Is that what you are saying?
What I'm just trying to say is we all understand empathy, okay. And that is very much important in any work. So if you want to succeed, if you want to make things, everybody take and lead by example. So empathizing is very much important. But to solve this kind of typical Scrum issues where people are working and still delivery is not happening, so people have to look little more than what are their own responsibilities.
True. And this is just a starting point.
Yeah.
So this is just a starting point, not a solution.
Yeah.
This starts giving you an ear and eye, which helps you in seeing the problem and make other people see the same. Because till the time you don't have, the way we did an empathy map exercise,
yeah.
It doesn't solve anything. It just connects you so that you can start seeing and hearing what is needed to be heard. Very rightly pointed out to clarify that it is just a start. After that, you need to do something. You can't just keep sitting and empathizing with a person who is unable to deliver. Great point. I think I am done. So thank you for listening.